I want to share with you a story of a famous hero and king from the Bible. Now, if you believe in the God, or if you don't, this is a story you are going to want to know. Especially if you're involved in the marriage debate. Because this is the story of David and what it shows about God and polygamy. That's right, that's what I just said, polygamy. Let me introduce myself to you, for those of you especially who aren't familiar with who I am. My name is Mark Henkel, and I am the National Polygamy Advocate for the National Polygamy Rights Movement for Consenting Adults. And because I am not a Mormon, not a Muslim, not a liberal, not lascivious, but actually an evangelical Christian who founded the truthbearer.org organization, I have been in numerous major national media, TV, newspapers, magazines, proposing the polygamy rights win-win solution to end the marriage debate in a way that everybody can win once and for all. And it's a simple solution: abolish all marriage control for unrelated consenting adults. So, whether you believe in God or not, this is a story you're going to want to know, because this is the story of David and what it shows about God and polygamy. Now, David is one of the most famous, important heroes of the Bible. It says that when he was first anointed by what's called the prophet Samuel in 1 Samuel chapter 16, says that the Holy Ghost descended upon him then and was on David all the way through, and it says right up to his last breath in 2 Samuel chapter 23. And it says many times in the Bible that David did everything that was right in the sight of the Lord, save only in the matter of Uriah the Hittite. And it says that more than once. I'm going to tell that story. The story of David and what it shows. You see, David was just a shepherd boy. And he was a musician and he wrote psalms. He wrote songs. In fact, the book of Psalms are David's songs. And he was anointed when the prophet Samuel came to anoint one of the sons of Jesse. And he was the youngest, and he's the one who ended up getting the anointing. And he received what was said to be the Holy Ghost upon him, and then starts doing great things. You've heard of the story of David and Goliath, where King Saul, the king of Israel, was unable, his kingdom and his military couldn't defeat this giant named Goliath. And here comes a shepherd boy with his slingshot, and slays Goliath. As a consequence, David becomes this great hero, and King Saul has David lead his military. And so David goes off having conquest after conquest, and he's very successful. The people are excited. They even create a song, how Saul hath killed his thousands, but David his tens of thousands. Now this suddenly starts making King Saul kind of jealous and nervous about this growing popularity. And David marries his first wife, a princess, the daughter of King Saul. And as David's popularity continues to grow and grow, Saul gets more and more jealous. And eventually, he even threatens David's life. And David knows he has to escape. So, with the help of his wife Michal, he escapes, but Michal has to stay behind. King Saul is furious. And he has Michal given away to someone else named Phaltiel. But David's on the run. He's on the lam from King Saul. The Bible says God blessed David and starts building his political power and family. First he builds 400 men start following David. And he's got this troop of 400 men. Then the story goes on and God brings two, not one, but two new women to him that David marries, two wives. No named wives, Abigail and Ahinoam. Then builds his political power, adds 200 more men. Then more political power, gives him the whole town of Ziklag. Now one day when David and his men were out in battle, a tribe of the Amalekites came and burned down the town and carried the stuff away, and it says took away David's two wives. David and the men came back to Ziklag. And they were distraught. The men were so furious, they actually wanted to kill David. And David seeks the Lord. What should I do, God? Should I pursue? And God says to him, chase after the Amalekites. you shall recover all. And so David and his men go and they pursue after the Amalekites. And it says that David recovered all. And the exact words of 1 Samuel chapter 30 verse 18 say, "And David rescued his two wives." God helped him bring them come back. While David was at that battle of the Amalekites, that was his alibi, because at that same time, King Saul was in a separate battle elsewhere. And he gets mortally wounded and then has his servant finish him off. So Saul is killed. This creates a power vacuum, because now there's not the kingdom run by the king of Israel. Well, people call for David to come rule Judah. Saul's son Ish-bosheth rules the remaining tribes of Israel. So again, God is building up David even more power. Now he's the king of Judah at 30 years old. And while he's reigning for those 7.5 years as the king of Judah, the Bible says he marries 4 more wives. Maacah, Haggith, Abital, and Eglah. Michal is still with Phaltiel, carried off in Israel. So 6 of these wives are with David as he's the king of Judah, and each one bears him a son. And through this time, David calls for Ish-bosheth to return Michal to him, so Michal comes back as well. And then through some other situations, Ish-bosheth is assassinated. David didn't want anything to do with that, and when people tried to brag that they're the ones who did it, he actually had them put to death, because he was not in favor of having that assassination. And consequently, the people wanted David to become the king of Israel. And so the concept we have here is David is the king of all Israel. God has built up his power and his family as now he has 7 wives and 6 sons as he's the king of Israel. But one night, as the king of Israel, he gets to the rooftop and he looks out. And he sees a beautiful woman taking a bath, bathing herself. And he calls, "Who is that woman?" "Oh, sir, that's Bathsheba. She's the wife of Uriah the Hittite, who's out on the battle lines working with the army for you. Bring her to me." Well, one thing leads to another, and next thing you know, Bathsheba's pregnant. And David has a drama, a soap opera, if you will, because now he's got to find a way to cover it up. And so he calls for Uriah to come back off the battle lines and try to find a way to go be with his wife so that Uriah will think that he's the father of the child when it's born. But Uriah won't have any of that. He sleeps outside the door of the king, David, because he says, if my fellow guys in the army, and they're not going to be able to be with their family, I'm not going to be with mine. So without this honorable man, he will not go and be with it. David's frustrated. What am I going to do? So next night he tries to get him drunk, and Uriah still won't do it. So David finally sends Uriah the Hittite back to fighting at the war front and tells the captain, put him in the front line where it's most dangerous. And sure enough, the intention as it was meant to be, according to David's design with this situation, is Uriah the Hittite was put to the front line and killed. And this was the situation that displeased God. And God sent a man who was called a prophet named Nathan. And Nathan comes to David and tells him, there was a rich man with many sheep and a poor man with one sheep. And a traveler came to town and the man with many sheep wanted to take care of the traveler. But he didn't want to use any of his own, so he took this man's one sheep and gave to the traveler. David was enraged with the injustice. This man shall surely have justice, and fourfold shall he return to this poor man. And Nathan says to him, thou art the man. And then it says, thus saith the Lord, which is the Bible's way of saying, God is talking directly to David in 2 Samuel 12:7-8. and said, this is God saying to David, I gave you the kingdom of Israel, and I gave you all your wives, and if you had wanted more, I would have given you more. That's what God himself said in 2 Samuel 12:8. And then he goes on, but you took this man's one wife and had him killed. Instantly, David knew his sin. And he repented, I have sinned. And the child that was in Bathsheba's womb died. And then eventually she became his wife and had another son that would be Solomon. But what we see from this is that the matter of Uriah the Hittite was that he had taken another man's wife and had him killed. He was never called out for his multiple wives. He was never told to abandon his family. And in fact, not only that, God himself said he had built up David's polygamous family. And said if David had wanted more, he would have given him more. So whether you believe in God or not, or you believe in the Bible or not, if you're involved in the marriage debate, now you know the story of David and what it shows.